Hi guys, and welcome back to Coyfish Johnny. It's been an emotional journey and an educational one trying to understand exactly what is coming out of my tap water and what is in my pond. These phosphates are, the findings in relation to them are absolutely incredible. Because my phosphate reading is so high through the roof, which is like a turbo to the bloody algae, because it's so high, one person commented and said, are there any local building works going on? Like, is there any estates being built or anything like that? Any major developments happening at the minute? Because if it is, then United Utilities put higher phosphate or mess around with the water basically to compensate for the new pipe work that's happening, so it doesn't erode new things. I absolutely have no idea, but basically it changes the minerals and everything that's inside the water that comes to us. I honestly thought at no point in my life would I ever be talking to a camera about water and what's inside our water, but now that I'm starting to dig into it a little bit, I actually find it a little bit interesting. I know it's strange, but and then it sort of promotes your brain to think on these weird conspiracy ideas about what we're actually consuming in water. But anyway, let's not go there. So I've tested the tap water for its phosphate, which was really high, and I checked it for my KH levels, which was actually really low. So I thought, this is all a bit odd now. And as you guys pointed out, the last time in my last video, I made a mistake. I shouldn't have put the KH buffer all in at once. I should have done it systematically and slowly and progressively. And also, rather than using KH buffer, which is probably one of the most expensive things I've ever bought, as a powder to treat the water, I got some remarkable people. There must have been about 10, 11, 12 people, some of which I have huge respect for, just come out and said, listen, John, you're wasting your dollar there, mate. It's costing, you're paying well over the odds for the KH buffer up. Get bicarbonate soda off. Well, if you Google it, you can find out where to buy it, and it's a fraction of the price, and it does just the same job, which is what I'm going to be talking about in a minute, which pH scale, because a pH scale, as you know, guys, is super important, because if it goes below 4.5, your fish will die. So that's why you need, anyone starting out, make sure you monitor it. Everybody says when you start koi fishing and you go to the koi shops, make sure you do your checks. Do not do your checks, if that makes sense. You've got to check the pH. Your fish will die at 4.5 or less than 4.5. They'll just die. The acidity is too high. Anyway, back to what I was talking about a minute ago. When I started looking at this pH, it really intrigued me. And I started looking at things a little bit like, I got onto one subject about the acidity within the human lining and the stomach being at like 1 on the scale. So that means basically we can digest our stuff. But then I looked at why. So that brought a question into my mind, like, what's the best level of, or what's the highest level of acidity within her stomach? Turns out the turkey vulture, which is also in the Jurassic Park films, I'm sure it is, with a smell for 2 miles. The turkey vulture's stomach is at like 0, which is 100 times more violent against digesting things, and basically it's resilient against anything. The stomach of a turkey vulture can literally digest, I mean, check this out. The turkey vulture's stomach can digest anything that's got rabies. You know, like when you think of it, it's got a dead carcass, so it's digesting, can digest anthrax, rabies, and other words that I can't pronounce, but if you Google it, it's actually quite interesting. But yeah, the humans are like 1 or something, I think it's 1, and the turkey vulture is practically at 0. But a sloth is at 6, which means it digests slower, which fits in with a sloth. And also interestingly, the snake's digestive system sits at 7, but when it eats, the pH scale in its stomach goes up within 24 hours all the way to 2, up to 2, so it can digest its food. That's why you see a snake when he's eating a meal, he's chilling out for ages. Anyway, back to the fish. Now, here's a little question for you. If I just whittled off all those animals there with their digestive system, or listed all the animals with the pH scale of their stomach, what is the pH scale of a koi fish's or a koi's stomach? Go on, have a little think, have a little guess, talk about it. You guessed it, it's a trick question. They don't have a stomach, they have a straight intestinal tract. I think I'm pronouncing that right, I'm not 100%. Intestinal tract, basically, it just goes in and gets digested really quick. So whenever the fish eat the food, they basically consume it and digest it within 4 hours, apparently. So they don't have a stomach. So there's a little trick question for you guys, and something that's a little bit of fun there. But anyway, back to the pH scale. So what I'm saying is, when you, one thing that I wanted to make clear, especially to beginners out there, You do get told all the time, really check everything out, check the parameters in your pond, And as a younger car keeper, or not younger car keeper, but someone newer to the game, I've got to say, I neglected that a little bit. I thought it was a bit dramatic, but in all honesty, it's not. Oh, and in relation to the pH scale, I'm just going to throw up a little thing on the screen if I manage to pop it in somewhere like here, maybe. I don't know, I've never done that before, so I hope that works. Otherwise, I'm going to look like a bit of a clown. But there, we can look through the pH scale, and you can see 4.5, the fish die, the digestive system, car batteries. Turkey vulture's stomach is more acidic than a car battery. Jesus Christ, I would not like to be eaten by that thing. Not that I'd like to be eaten by anything, but definitely not turkey vulture. So you can see, I did find it quite interesting looking up and down, and then you can see the bicarbonate soda up there and the alkalinity. What is interesting about the KH, actually, I'm going to pop this up, which is the thing that I use. I use this NT Labs Pond Lab thing, and I find it remarkably good. I enjoy doing it. A, it makes me feel like a scientist, which is cool now that... It wasn't when I was back at school, which is why I'm struggling with all this terminology and stuff like that. I just find it a little bit hard to adapt to, but nonetheless, I will live and I will learn. So, there you go. Anyone that's starting out, ammonia, massively important to stay at zero or as close as you can to being yellow. Yellow means zero. So that if that goes high, that will kill your fish. That's why they got schools on there. Probably shouldn't be holding this in my hand, but if you Google it, you'll be able to see it yourself. The ammonia, when that goes up, it kills your fish, which is basically the fish poo. But another thing about ammonia is that it's really good for plants. So if you've got plants like I've got laurels on the outside of my garden, all the way over there, on the outside, on the parameter, that is like a turbo for plants to grow. So the ammonia, you see a lot of people with plants in their pond, they'll be feeding off stuff like that, and the nitrate. Ammonia to nitrate, which is also really dangerous for your fish in high. There shouldn't be any in your pond, but sometimes with changes in season, especially in spring, you can get some in there. And then there's nitrate. Now, nitrate apparently is not dangerous to your fish, but it's not good in your pond. But the interesting thing about nitrate is, nitrate is like a turbo for algae. So when you've got problems like I've got, which is the green pond syndrome, which everybody gets, if you've got high levels of nitrate, the last one with an A, so nitrate, which is the third stage of the biological change, so a biological filtration change, so it will go from ammonia to nitrite to nitrate. But if you've got high nitrate 8, so the one with the A, that will be like a turbo to the algae. It will just feed the algae. And then if you've got high phosphate like I've got, so you're gonna have high phosphate because of the building works that's going on in your pond, and then you're gonna have a high nitrate 8, which I had a while back. As you remember with the pond crash, I think it's about episode 45 or something, I had a really bad crash at the same time as having COVID. And my nitrate was through the roof, which led to initiating this problem, along with the phosphate, which has maintained it, and along with the KH being low. If we move on now to the fourth one, which is acidity, which is your pH scale, which I've just been waffling on about for ages there. Your pH is like neutral is 7, so alkalinity is up to 14, and acidity, like the turkey vulture, all the way down to 0. Your fish die at 4.5 on the acidity scale, so you can see the intent, the danger of that. So with that, you always want to monitor that. That, the ammonia and the pH scale are the most important. If you're gonna monitor three, not that you ever monitor three because you just do them all, they're the three that you wanna really, really, really pay attention to. That's what I'm learning anyway. Then you've got the alkalinity, which is the KH, the KH, the carbonate hardness within it. That's like a buffer. So basically, apparently, this is what I've read and what my understanding is at this particular moment. The KH is like a buffer. It stops the pH flying up and flying down or flying all off or flying down or becoming dangerous to the fish. So basically, the KH is like a stabilizer, and I've had issues with my KH recently. And that means that my pH is vulnerable. And if my pH is vulnerable and takes a dramatic drop because it's not supported by the KH, then if the pH goes flying down, my fish will die. So that's why KH is important, because it supports your pH, okay? I sound really, really odd talking to myself here, because I honestly have zero idea about this about before I started pond keeping. I didn't pay attention in science at school. The only thing I was interested in was a Bunsen burner, but I love my fish now and I'm having to grow this knowledge. And also I'm gonna love it because I get the opportunity to teach my children as I'm growing up, as they're growing up, all about the periodic table or about elements that I'm starting to understand. Thanks to you guys that are supporting my growth out there, and thanks to these fish, which bring a massive amount of pleasure to my life. All I'm saying is, I'm not a scientific expert. I am not a know-it-all. I'm a guy that is learning. And that's one of the things about this hobby. When you do get into it, a lot of people might not get into it because it overwhelms them looking at this KH, pH, ammonia, nitrate, nitrite, phosphates, biological filtration, mechanical filtration, which, by the way, mechanical filtration, biological filtration, mechanical filtration is just taking the big parts out, like the big parts of poo and the big parts of stuff that can't pass through somewhere and gets filtered out your water. Biological filtration is a completely different thing. In a nutshell, that is the converting of ammonia to nitrate, which isn't good for the fish, and then converting it to nitrate, which is harmless to the fish but good for the algae. So you also want to get rid of that, and that's where, you know, like in the nexus in the outer chamber, you've got air pumping and a large surface areas where good biological elements can grow and bad and it filters out, converts the bad stuff to good stuff, basically. That's all that biological filtration means. But there is a lot to this cod keeping hobby, a hell of a lot that you've got to learn. But there are bare necessities and you really don't need to be overwhelmed by it. And when you talk to people, people enjoy their own opinions, shall we say. And with this, there are people with their own opinions, and that's beautiful. But you formulate your own and you learn. As long as you're monitoring your water quality and your water parameters, and that's why you'd start with smaller fish, in my opinion. A, because the love of growing them and seeing them grow is just one of the best part. I mean, Fred was a tinky winky little tiny fish for like 12 quid and now he's huge, in my opinion he's huge. I know there's some monsters out there, but we're looking to get him over 50-60 centimeters this year. So there's a lot to learn, and it can really get overwhelming, like the vortex spinning around, why that's important, why it's got to go down a 4-inch drain, why you need a UV light, and we're not going to go there with UV lights because I hate UV lights. But they're necessary for binding the algae together so it can then go into your filtration, the mechanical filtration, and then go out of your system. And then the phosphates supporting the green water. But what I'm saying is there's a lot to learn, but it's enjoyable learning about it. It is enjoyable learning about all this stuff if you just spend a little bit of time looking and measuring your pond, looking at your fish, enjoying them grow and learning. I'm saying the knowledge on this subject is endless. I don't think there's one definitive person out there that knows everything about koi, the optimal way to grow them, the best this and the best that. Because imagine in Japan, when I do go to Japan, I'll be looking around, there won't be just one person at the top of the pyramid that knows everything. The two top breeders in the world might have different ways of doing things, slightly different, but it won't be definitive, is what I mean. And that's the same with you guys when you start your pond. Every pond is different. There's new pond it syndrome. Anyway, I've waffled on and on and on and on and on about this. So now, one of the things that I need to talk to you about is what I've recently took with all this knowledge in my head. Thanks to Jamie for being ultra supportive and great conversations with him. I've had some great conversations with him and he's offered some great support, especially with the bicarbonate soda, because I was a little bit nervous about adding that to the pond. So I buffered the KH up, as you know, I did too much, but it's only gone to like 3, just under 4. So the pond is sitting above 2, which is really important because the resolve only works if the KH levels in the pond are above 2. So I've waited 10 days, that's passed. The KH is up above 2. It can't, apparently the KH can't go too high because that's just a stabilizer, but it can go too low. Okay, so like the ammonia can go too high, nitrate too high, nitrite too high. pH, you want sitting and bang on really, that can go too high and too low. But KH, you ideally want it at like 6, but apparently when I've been looking at it, and this is what Google says, apparently it can't go too high because it just stabilizes the pH. So back to what I was saying, because I'm waffling again. The KH is up, so I can bang the resolve in because that works above 2. I banged the resolve in, I didn't quite have enough, I was like 20 grams short, which is a bit of a thingy. So I poured it all in yesterday, and I've got the pump speeds rocking around still at 90. In fact, in the next episode, which I'll hopefully be able to record this week because it's Wednesday today, I'm going to be altering my pump speeds due to the effects it's had on my water, and also discussing some of the things, undesirable things, that increasing my pump speed has had on my pond, because it has, and it's not cheesed me off, but it's just not what I want. Do you know what I mean? So I'm going to be changing that. So please like and subscribe. Please subscribe to the channel. We're growing every single day. Thank you so much. Please get involved by commenting. I enjoy reading the comments. I learn from the comments. Please take care and please enjoy crying, and don't be too harsh on me if I've got anything slightly wrong or wrong with all this stuff, because I am literally learning on the job and I'm not a scientist. Take care, guys.